We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
Birds flying high, you know how I feel. Sun in the sky, you know how I feel. Rain drifting on by, you know how I feel. It's a new dawn, it's a new day, it's a new life for me. And I'm feeling good.
Hello and welcome to La La Land on LA Talk Live. That's Dorothy Dillingham Blue.
And there's Brett Chapin.
Thanks for joining us on La La Land. This is the only nationally broadcast show by Los Angeles artists about Los Angeles artists on episode 136. My camera's so high today.
It is very high. Yeah. Yes.
Hi, Dorothy.
Hi, Brett.
Okay, so first of all, we have an amazing guest on the show today.
Yes, we do.
Mr. Barry Pearl mm-hmm. of the Pasadena Playhouse's 12 Angry Men.
Great.
Can't wait to talk to him.
Yeah.
And beyond that, before we even get to Barry, you told me you had an amazing Monday.
I did.
And I'm wondering what made your Monday so amazing?
What made my Monday so amazing is that my dear friend Tim Misko, who works over at Warner Brothers and who's a member of the Producers Guild, took me to the Guild screening of Saving Mr. Banks, which is a film coming out in December, probably Christmas. I have a feeling that it's... Not that it's Christmassy, but it's very Oscar-y. And that's the story about the creative process of taking P.L. Travers' book, Mary Poppins, to the screen. And there was a lot of creative clash between her and Walt Disney and the screenwriter and the music team of Robert and Richard Sherman. And it's about the creative process, but it's also about what makes a person become who they are, either as a person or an artist. And so it was really fascinating. Afterwards, there was a panel discussion with Emma Thompson, Tom Hanks, Colin Farrell,
nice.
John Lee Hancock, Robert Sherman.
Oh, they don't know what they're talking about.
Oh, I'm sorry, Richard. Oy. And it was just really fascinating to hear them talk about what that experience was, because P.L. Travers, she insisted that her meetings, all the discussions about the screenplay and the movie itself be recorded, have an audio recording so that she could say that, well, yes, I did say this, or I didn't agree to that. So they had all these hours to listen to her, and wow, I mean, and the discussions that they had and they're played out on screen, you'd think there's no way that actually happened, that she wasn't that... insistent or that difficult, because, you know, there's only one word for the way she was in some points, and that was difficult. And it was, and they played some of those tracks over the credits, and sure enough, word for word. It was,
yeah.
Wow.
Well, how does Tom Hanks fit into the picture? Does he play Walt Disney?
He plays Walt Disney.
Does he?
He plays
That's
Walt Disney.
That's a great choice.
It is a great choice, and here's what happened with that. He told a great story about why he was playing Walt Disney, because the question was asked from the audience to the screenwriter and the producer, whose names I forget, that was there any clash with the Walt Disney Company about doing this production? Like, did they come to any sort of disagreement or anything? And the whole creative team said there was none. There was absolutely none. They were waiting for it every day. John Lee Hancock said he woke up like this every morning, waiting for the phone call that they were canning it or they had to cut certain parts of it. And that call and that email and that memo never came. But then Tom Hanks goes, yep. So here's what happened. So Bob Iger calls him. You know, he picks up the phone. It's like, hold for Bob Iger, please. And so he can hear him. He's in the car, and he can hear him go, Tom, they're doing this. There's this movie. It's about Walt, and we got to do it. And see him act this whole thing. He goes, and you got it. You're going to have to help me out, man. You're going to have to come in and play. You got to play Walt. You know, just do me this favor. You know, you owe me, man. And I mean, I know that you really owe me, but I mean, you kind of owe me. And it was a hoot to hear him talk about it.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
I don't know what's with all the Disney stuff lately. Like, there's a When You Wish is playing over at UCLA. You know, there's all kinds of Disney things going on lately. Mm-hmm. I don't know if it's the anniversary of, well, I know it's the 40th anniversary of Disneyland being built. But
right. And then there's Escape from Tomorrow. That's the one that was shot on the QT.
There's another one?
There's a film. It's this guy who, in all black and white, he shot this underground film on Disney property. It's about this.
That's awesome.
Yeah, and some of it takes place in the It's a Small World, and so which means they had to go on It's a Small World multiple times. They had hidden cameras. Mm-hmm. I would be excited to see that. But it was
not
it was
that we endorse guerrilla filmmaking on La La Land, but that's awesome.
I do.
Yeah, you do.
Oh, I do. Dorothy Dillingham Blue endorses guerrilla filmmaking. I mean, go for it. Okay.
Half of us do on the record.
Whatever. But it was fascinating to hear them talk about how, you know, the creative process and Richard Sherman was on the panel and Tom Hanks had talked about, you know, there's endless footage of Walt Disney being Walt Disney. And one of the clips he remembered was the opening of Tomorrowland. And the theme song for Tomorrowland was one of his favorite songs. And he started to sing it and Richard Sherman joins in because he wrote the song. So I'm sitting there, second row, watching these two legends just sing the theme song to Tomorrowland. It was amazing. It was amazing.
So cool.
It was. Yeah.
One of the best experiences I think I've ever had in L.A. was going to see, I saw my friend Jimmy Mulligan's cabaret show. He's been a guest on the show. And he brought with him Richard Sherman.
Oh.
And so to accompany him. And Richard Sherman is just sitting there. He's playing piano.
He's delightful.
He's doing It's a Small World, and he said, everyone sing along, and I'm singing along, and I'm going, I'm singing along with the guy that wrote the freaking song.
Yes.
Like, unbelievable.
And he told us the story of how he became a writer for Walt Disney. Is he'd been doing small things, you know, one song here or there, but he and his brother really wanted to be in-house composers and music guys for Walt Disney, and the song that nailed that for them was Feed the Birds. That was the song, and Walt Disney, that's what the story is about, is it only takes a little bit of something to help someone continue in their life. It's just feeding the birds. Mm-hmm. It's, you know, it's a couple tuppence a bag. I mean, it's that small little bit.
You know, they were going to cut A Spoonful of Sugar?
Oh, I know. I mean, in the film, you'll see why. But I mean, she was against, Pale Travers did not want music at all. No music.
Which is crazy.
Right. Yeah. She wanted absolutely no animation, and she did not want the color red.
How do you take out the color red from...
Well,
I mean, it's I guess you can do it, but it's weird.
The reason why is she wanted to see how committed Walt Disney was to getting this made into a film. She was going to make it as difficult as possible. It was really fascinating.
And then it wins. Like, didn't win the Oscar for Best Picture that year, or it was at least nominated.
I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know the answer to
that. Anyway, either way, it did really, really well.
It did.
Yeah.
It did. It certainly is ingrained in the childhood memories of millions. Millions, really.
Yeah. So. It's true.
Yeah.
A lot of Disney talk on the show today.
Yeah.
Disney sponsorship?
I know. Seriously. And then we're going to go see a show today. We don't know what, though.
But it's at the Geffen Playhouse, which is a great playhouse.
Yes, we know it's at the Geffen, but we're not real sure which one it is because there's two.
There's two at the same
time. At 3 o'clock. And my friend Holly Luft-Pressman, bless her heart, she's like, she emails me, oh, I've got two tickets for a show at the Geffen tomorrow at 3. I'm like, yay, what's the show? And she never really told me. So she just told me where to pick the tickets up from her house. And so we're going to go.
This is going to be a surprise theater show. Yeah. I love it. It's going to be fun.
So like,
I hope it's Waiting for Dark, though. That's a good show.
That would be fun.
Yeah. But if it's the other one, I'll be happy to. It's free theater tickets. You can't. You know, beggars can't be choosers. And I'm in a show.
You are in a show. You opened last night. Thursday.
Thursday. I opened Thursday.
Yes.
So much fun. The Bel Air at the El Portal Theater. It's a beautiful, beautiful space. And, you know, I remember when I first moved to LA, I drove by it because it was in my neighborhood. And I want to work there someday. I'm getting the opportunity to. So it's so great.
That is great.
I have a tremendous cast. And then thank you, studio audience. A tremendous cast, and it's a great show. Come see us. We're 5 performances a week, Thursday nights, Friday nights, ooh, Saturday nights, Sunday matinees, and Sunday nights.
Wow.
Go to elportaltheater.com for information, or place411.com for information on that. And cast and crew is coming in here next week.
Brilliant.
So they're going to be able to talk to us about it.
Love it.
Fun stuff.
Yes, yes. I've been working on an audiobook this week.
Yeah, you have.
I have. That's exhausting
work.
And
what is this an audiobook for?
It's an audiobook for the listening library, which is primarily for English learners. So with the book, sometimes you can have a slight... For instance, the story that I'm doing is a historical novel set in the Civil War era. So, mm-hmm, of course, there need to be Southern accents there. And they aren't always syllable for syllable in the South. And with other books that I've done that involved using my Southern accent, it didn't have to be syllable for syllable. But for this one, it actually does, because they're learning how to speak English and they're following along word for word with the book.
Oh.
Yes. So you have to go back. And I mean, if you skip a syllable, if you skip a word, if it's at all unintelligible, then you have to go back. So it's been an adventure. Usually it doesn't take me as many days as it has for this book. And but man, whew. But I'm loving it. I'm loving it.
Are you having to do any accents or any voices of characters? Anything
like
that? Oh,
yes. Yeah? Absolutely. Male,
that's
female.
That's got to be so much fun.
Yeah, male, female. The age range of my characters is 8 to about 87.
Oh, wow.
And then and male and female throughout, Southern and Yankee, as well as, and this is important because it is set in a Civil War era, they are both Caucasian and African American, and African, like straight up African. So... Oh. I have to do the accents of all of those characters. No, that would be Aboriginal.
Oh, okay. Yes. Sorry. Okay. I get confused sometimes. that's really cool.
Mm-hmm.
I love that, you know, one of the things I love about the show is that it's about being an artist and being a performer, but we're also both working artists, too.
We are.
And
have
lately,
you seen,
a lot, especially.
Yeah, I know. Have you seen my big lots?
Oh, let's talk about your big lots.
Loving my big lots. I love it.
Dorothy got 5 Big Lots commercials that she has taped.
Currently
there's one running, right?
There's 3 running
right
now.
There's 3 running.
There's going to be 5 more coming down the pike.
Okay, so you 8.
Yeah, at least. I mean, I don't know when. But I'm loving every minute of it. We had Ashley Nicole Black a couple weeks ago. She was one of my fellow deal divas for Big Lots. And so, you know, catch us. It's going to be a fun time.
Yeah, it's posted actually on our Facebook page if you guys want to check it out.
It is.
Looking good up there.
Yep, I'm the voice and I'm the girl in green marching around getting all the good deals.
And you're like the leader of the 4 girls.
I am.
I feel like. You were the tallest. So
I look the tallest, which is strange because I'm not that tall. So.
I know, you look monstrously tall next to Ashley.
I know, isn't that weird?
And you guys are about the same height.
We're about the same height. And I don't know, I don't know if it's my Pilates or if I know I'm wearing heels on my boots, but yeah, and I got to drive the minivan and all that, and it was tough because at one point it's fine because you're hooked to a truck.
Yeah.
Like when you see people driving on screen, they're not actually driving most of the time, so that was fun. You know, I had to make sure it looked like I was driving. But earlier in the shoot on another day at about 4 o'clock in the morning, it's pitch black dark except for the lights of the parking lot, and I had to drive through a wall of fog wearing sunglasses with three passengers plus a PA in the trunk.
It's always good to keep an extra PA in the trunk.
I know,
just in
that's
case.
What we all need. It was hilarious. And I was, you know, you wouldn't think there would be anyone else that you would have to dodge on at that, but there was this woman that was trying to get to a drive-through ATM and she was hella pissed. And so I'm on the walkie-talkie like, I think I just pissed off a bank customer. They're like, it's all right, you're doing fine.
You know what? They can just wait for your art.
Seriously.
You know? That's awesome. So check out Dorothy's Big Lots commercials.
Yeah.
She's been working hard.
Working hard. Deal divas. Woohoo!
Good stuff. The Foreigner at Theater Palisades.
Yes. That is on its second weekend.
It's on its second weekend. Mm-hmm. I went and saw it.
Yes.
Hilarious.
That's a funny show.
Yeah, it really is.
Yep.
And I think the set is not, like, it's not quite the insane, elaborate set that Sherman does well, But it works perfectly for the show because that show is so much about the dialogue and about the comedy and about the words and the timing. It's not so much about the set. It's nice to see that our set designer, Sherman Wayne, has gotten a break on this one.
He has, yes. And then auditions for Theater Palisades' youth production of Ever After, a musical, are this coming Thursday, the 21st, from 4 to 6:30, and Saturday, the 23rd, from 2 to 5. So if you have an 8 to 15-year-old that is interested in musical theater, come on down to Theater Palisades. You can visit the TP Youth page at theaterpalisades.com for more information.
Which I might add is right up the street from the Santa Monica Pier.
It really is.
It's very, very close.
It's so close. People are like, oh my God, it's so far. I'm like, no, it's not Malibu. It's not Malibu.
That's what it is, isn't it? People think Palisades is Malibu.
They
do. They think it's
Malibu. I'm like, no.
No, it's basically Santa Monica.
Exactly.
Yeah. So come to the auditions.
Yes.
If you're 8 to 15.
Yes. Musical of Musical the Musicals.
You saw
also
that?
Also running.
Yes.
Excellent show.
How
crazy.
Was that?
Oh, I saw that. I saw that before last week's show, and it was insane. I'm still laughing about some of the stuff that was in that show. It was ridiculous. The Kristen Towers roles. What I love is that she's done so much that she has a great perspective about what to send up. It's all there in the script. It's all there in the music. But they're little extras of you know, she totally sends up what it is to have a technically overdone show and what you can making fun of that. And it was really funny. So absolutely see it. It is a go. I think it's a critic's pick and a go for LA Weekly. So
love it.
Yeah.
Go check it out.
Mm-hmm.
I know Kristen.
Yes.
We've met once or twice.
Just a few times.
Yeah. Kristen was in Little Shop of Horrors with me at Kentwood Players, and yes. I should show you that I'm wearing my Little Shop of Horrors t-shirt. Shari Barrett, I'm wearing my Little Shop of Horrors t-shirt. I promised I would 1 week, and I'm keeping my promise.
All right.
That was a great experience.
Excellent.
I should also talk about our friend Lena Gwendolyn Hill, who was going to call in today briefly to talk about her show that's opening at the Lemon Room on Tuesday. It's a one-night-only cabaret performance. Lena Gwendolyn and friends. She is a fantastic artist, and she will also be here next week to tell us how it went.
Fabulous.
So you can get tickets there at the Lemon Room LA.
Excellent. Cool.
I think that's about it, huh?
Yes. Oh, also, can I just say there needs to be better support for parents out there when it comes to like having sick children. My poor son, he had a terrible ear infection. We had his huge birthday party on Sunday. It was nuts. Like bounce house at the park, windy. I got everything from Costco. It was Angry Birds and it was nuts. Everybody running around. We had a fabulous time. And I guess the 5-year-old version of a hangover is a raging ear infection. Because that's what he got that night. Like that night, seriously, he was screaming like my teeth hurt, my ear hurt. And the next day I had to go. I had to leave him with the sitter and
poor little guy.
It was a mess. It was sad. And then he threw up, and it was really sad.
Call in with your well wishes for Dorothy's son.
For Rex.
Yes.
Rex. But Rex. He's doing much better now. But, you know, he threw up, and the sitter goes, he said, oh, no, I need to get back to my clean self.
I feel that way many times myself. Can't blame him.
And the doctor was trying to listen to his lungs. He goes, oh, no, they're too quiet.
You don't want quiet lungs. No, that's never good.
And it's that nasty medicine we have to give him. Sorry, I'm talking about my son, but, you know, that's how it is because I'm a mom.
It's all about you.
It's all about me. So and he's taking that nasty chalky medicine. He's taking little tiny sips of it. And he goes, oh, mommy, you provide the small sips, and I love you.
That's cute. Mom, provider of small sips. Small if you have sips. Any questions about small sips, Rex, or Barry Pearl, make sure to give us a call at
323-473-3100.
323-473-3100. It's all up in the noggin.
It's all in the noggin.
Right. You can also send us questions on Twitter at LaLaLandTalk. You can send us an email at LaLaLandTalk@gmail.com. You can find us on Facebook at Facebook.com/LaLaLandTalk. And I'm really excited to talk to Barry Pearl.
Me too.
He's in 12 Angry Men at the Pasadena Playhouse. He was Duty in the original movie of Grease. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
He has worked on Broadway in the lead role in Baby, It's You just recently, 2-3 years ago, something like that. 2011. Wow. The guy's phenomenal. So
excellent.
We'll be back to talk to him. Again, any questions, 323-473-3100. We'll be back on La La Land, episode number 136 with Brett and Dorothy on LA Talk Live.
This is Brett Chapin.
And this is Dorothy Dillingham Blue, inviting you to join us every Saturday at noon Pacific Standard Time for our show, La La Land Talk.
Join us as we talk with some of the top talent in LA. Artists' untold stories, your phone calls, and live on-location broadcasts have made La La Land one of the best sources in LA for everything entertainment.
So don't forget to tune in to La La Land Talk.
Exclusively on LATalkLive.com.
You can also catch us on iTunes Radio, R&B, Live 365, Radio Flag, and now Stitcher Radio, or watch and listen directly at latalklive.com.
Saturdays at noon Pacific time. Find us on Facebook at facebook.com/lalalandtalk, Twitter, twitter.com/lalalandtalk. Reality radio handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is LA Talk Live.
And we are more than just talk. I think we've got a Shakespeare monologue or two we could do. Yeah.
Jazz hands.
Kickball change. Good That's stuff. What I'm saying.
Mm-hmm. I'll do some Pippin.
Ooh, yeah. Some miming. I'm in a box.
Hey, LA Talk Live listeners. Be sure to tune in to Bandwidth Mondo every Saturday from 3 to 4 p.m. to catch live in-studio performances from a new artist every week.
Also streaming on Radio Flag, iTunes Radio, Live 365, and Ustream.tv.
Hello, I'm Joel Ramirez.
And I'm Lolita Robinson-Coppage, and welcome to Joy in My House.
On LATalkLive.com. Inspirational radio.
With a touch of recovery.
A reality show where nothing is left unsaid.
And no one is insignificant who says it.
Exclusively on LATalkLive.com. You can also catch us on iTunes Radio R&B or watch us on Ustream TV.
Reality radio handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk.
Hi, this is Barbara Perkins, inviting you to join us every Sunday afternoon at 2:40 for Sisters at the Well Radio, a conversation with women about women. Join us as we share stories about current events, jazz events, business opportunities, health and wellness, entertainment, and so much more. So don't forget to tune in Sundays at 2:40, exclusively on LATalkLive.com. You can also catch us on iTunes Radio R&B, Live 365, Radio Flag, or watch and listen directly at LATalkLive.com. Reality radio handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk.
Hi, I'm Ro Williams, and I would like to invite you to join GospelRhythms.com every Sunday at 4 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time for our show, GospelRhythms.com Talk Live Radio. Join us as we celebrate Christians around the world in all genres of entertainment, as well as highlight interest stories on men and women who are making a difference and impacting their community. So don't forget to tune in to GospelRhythms.com Talk Live Radio, exclusively on LATalkLive.com. You can also catch us on iTunes under R&B or watch us live on Ustream TV. We are reality radio handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is GospelRhythms.com Talk Live Radio, on LATalkLive.com. We're more than just talk. We're heaven's party here on earth.
Welcome back to La La Land on LA Talk Live. That's Dorothy Dillingham Blue. I'm Brett Chapin. And we are talking with actor Barry Pearl. Thanks for joining us, Barry.
It's thrilling. Oh, thank you. I was expecting the sound of one hand clapping, actually. You know, the important thing here, I think, before we begin is... Mm-hmm.
Pull your mic closer.
Well, that's the most important thing. Yes. But yes. Next to that is, how am I looking with these cans in my head?
You're looking so darn sexy, I can barely deal.
That's all I needed to hear. Now okay. We can continue.
All right.
You know what you don't want to do, though?
What don't I want to do?
You don't want to do that.
No. You can't hear, and it would hurt the ears.
But
you could do one of those, because then you're hearing half.
Yeah, people have done that.
Like professionals do that.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
I'm going to put mine back.
Yeah.
We had a guest who thought that you were supposed to wear them that way, backwards way, and so we all kind of put them on that way, and we kind of did the show that way.
Because we didn't want them to feel bad.
Yeah.
You're a little hot, and I mean...
Thank you.
Well, you're welcome. But...
You can adjust it on that.
Yes.
Right
and
there.
Is there a...
It's number one knob, the number one knob.
This one right there?
Yes.
Okay, and down that way, right? Oh, that's much better. Now let me hear you talk.
There you go.
Say
how
testing.
Testing, 1, 2, 3.
Yes.
Good. That's a professional way of saying it, too. You did very nice. You didn't up your E's or your S's.
Oh, well, thank you.
Radio.
I have a little bit of practice. Just a little
just
bit.
Just a smidge.
Yeah.
Hey,
just
smidge.
A smidge.
I had a smidge, but it died. I didn't know what to feed it.
Well, these things do
happen.
It's
going to be one of those shows. You realize
that. Yeah, I can tell already.
So excited.
Do that again. I don't know if we heard.
What'd you do?
Oh, he's got to... It's not as funny when...
I didn't hear that the
first
time.
I didn't hear that either.
Yeah. There was so much laughter.
Oh, okay.
Because we were being hilarious.
How long has he been working here?
I don't know. He might be part owner of the place. I don't know.
Kind
of. No, Van's a good guy. Van and I, we shared some moments before
there
you
it
got.
Is.
Oh, yeah.
Really?
We're both from the same area of the United States, actually. He being from Philadelphia and me being from Lancaster, Pennsylvania. Oh, is that not up high enough for you, Brett? Now can you hear better?
Yeah, now I can hear you.
Oh, sure.
Yeah.
Okay, that wasn't my pod. That was yours. I didn't adjust yours.
Yes, right? We're on separate pods.
Separate pod.
Yeah.
We've always been.
That's how it works.
So, yeah. So where was I? Totally. Oh, Philadelphia.
Do you want to do the interview?
I wouldn't mind.
Please.
Right. No. He's from Philly and I'm from Lancaster, Pennsylvania.
Uh-huh.
But I got to tell you something, Van. Lancaster cheesesteaks beat Philadelphia cheesesteaks by far, my friend.
Ooh.
And that's a challenge.
That's fighting words.
Them's fighting words. But here's your Geno's. Here's your Pat's. Here's your Jim Steaks. Dottie's on Route 222 South between New Providence and Quarryville, Pennsylvania, between Memorial Day and Labor Day. She's only open because it's like a kind of an outdoor-y, Dairy Queen-ish looking kind.
Right.
You have never tasted a cheesesteak sandwich this good in your life.
Ooh, I wonder if Triple D's been there.
You know, I have wanted to get in touch with him to say, hey, I'll come to PA, because my cousin has a farm in New Providence, which is just outside of Lancaster. I'll come there in a summer, on my own dime, I'll come over, and I'll meet you at Dottie's, we'll do a little thingy thing. You know, I got a 50s connection with a small film called Grease.
Did you mention that small film?
and we could do a thing. You know, you taste these steaks and I tell you, tintinabulating pops in your tongue.
That is the first time tintinabulating has ever been used on the show.
It sounds rather sexy, doesn't it?
It does.
And
it does.
I feel very flattered and proud that I was able to be the first.
We appreciate it.
We love it.
With Dorothy and Brett, if I may, I would never, anybody from Philly really wouldn't take you to Pat's
or Geno's,
anyway.
You're right.
Because, they do...
Yeah, and cheese whiz.
I would take you to a mom and pop store.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
And get you the best steak sandwich.
Yeah, probably South Philly too. Yeah.
Yeah, South Philly, West Philly, North Philly.
Yeah.
Greater Northeast.
But, you know, and you're right. I have not eaten in those places, but I bet you're absolutely right. But my brains will fall out. I'm absolutely certain that you have those places. There's a place across in what's the first town in Jersey, right across from Philly. Begins with a C. Can't remember the name.
Camden.
Hello. When I was doing Happy Days, a new musical on tour, we played. We were playing in Philly, and then we went to Hershey. And this will tie in nice. In Philly, one of the gals in the show, Gabrielle Reed, who's now on Broadway with Beautiful, which is the new Carole King. Musical.
Yeah, she hasn't written a musical in how long?
Well, it's Jerry Goffin and her, and Jerry is a friend through. His wife, who is the late Jeff Conaway's sister, Michelle.
Oh, okay.
So Anyhow, she's Gabrielle has this friend in Camden that mm-hmm. has a restaurant, and those were delicious cheesesteaks as well. And then we went to Hershey. We're like a spit from Lancaster, and I told some of my castmates all about Dottie's, and you know, really hyped it as I'm doing now. And they went on their own because I'd given them directions. They went on their own down to Dottie's, and I'm thinking, gosh, I really hope that I haven't hyped this too much. I really hope they liked it. And I was at a Turkey Hill, which is like Turkey Hill, it's like a 7-Eleven, pumping gas, and my cell phone rings, and it's my friend Jeff Sumner saying, Barry, not only is this the best cheesesteak that I've ever eaten, this is the best thing that I've ever eaten. Hello.
Wow.
Hello, Guy Fieri. Calling Guy Fieri.
Okay, speaking of Guy Fieri, it's funny you bring him up.
Wait a minute. Let's talk about me. This isn't about Guy Fieri.
Yeah, but just for a minute, it's yes. about Guy Fieri.
Okay,
and cheesesteaks. Because I didn't yes. think that we'd be talking about cheesesteaks. But while
it's
we're on the subject.
It's never what you think it is, man. Go ahead.
I heard from him on Diners, Drive-Ins, and Dives.
You did?
I heard from him on the TV show.
Oh, I thought personally, because yes. then there'd be a whole new respect I'd be having for
that. That would be awesome. I wouldn't mind meeting the guy. I don't care what people say. I like the guy.
Oh, I love the guy. Go ahead.
I like him, too. My friend used to work for him on his crew, on his film, on his camera crew, and yeah. said he was a very stand-up guy.
Right.
And she's a woman working on a camera crew, so there's all kinds of things that can happen, and she said it was the most pleasant experience
That's
she's
great
ever had.
To hear.
Seems like a good guy. I watched that show religiously.
Oh, mm-hmm. fabulous.
But he says that the cheesesteaks, the cheese whiz is the way to go.
Yes, that's the original, that you're right.
Is that? Because you said you didn't like that.
I didn't like that. I like either white American or provolone.
Oh,
you know.
Okay.
But I just don't care for that taste. And you're right. The diehard original is like Steak'em, you know. But I guess it's morphed into what it's, you know, what Dottie is making and has been making for many, many years.
Lovely.
It's just fabulous. It's kind of a clear sauce. It's not a red. It's just a taste that and dense, heavy.
That's important. Sandwich. That's important in a cheesesteak.
And I don't know that it's an Amarosa roll either. It's a different kind of a roll because the Amarosa rolls are really, really delicious,
mm-hmm.
crunchy on the outside and soft on the inside.
Pretty expensive, I'd imagine, though.
Her steak, actually, I remember when they were $7.50 a piece, and that was a lot of money back in the day. And I think there's something like, closer to 10 for a large. And I'm talking the large is almost as wide as this table.
Oh,
and I can just about eat one of them. My mouth is watering.
I don't know where you go out, because the last time I was in Philly, I got me a mushroom steak sandwich for like five something.
An Upper Darby.
Nice.
Now, you know what I like every once in a while, then, is a little pepperoni chopped into it. Philly's best out here in California do a pretty good cheesesteak.
Huh.
When it first opened in Encino, I thought I'd died and gone to heaven, but for some reason it's kind of waned a little bit, and I don't know why. Maybe just that one, but they come pretty close.
There's a place in Burbank called South Street off of Magnolia there.
Yeah.
Great Philly cheesesteaks.
Really?
And they use the original rolls.
The Amarosa rolls.
Yeah.
Also on Lancashire, just east of Lancashire on Magnolia, Philadelphia cheesesteak. It's a small place on the south side. They're pretty good. It's a different taste, and they've got one also in Tarzana.
I've seen that, but that's right by my house. I've seen that place. So
there you go. And I think all these people should be sending you money for advertising.
I was going to say, can we have a Philly cheesesteak challenge on the show and all these places, and we just sample and see which one we like the best?
I love that. Please invite me.
I will. You could be one of our judges.
I would love that.
I'm seriously.
Do it.
I want to contact every place we've talked about, honestly.
Absolutely. That's a great idea. Do a thing like a remote or something. Can you do a remote for me?
We have
to come here.
Well, we can do a remote. Yeah.
That'd be very hip.
That would be very cool.
A cheesesteak challenge, a cook-off, if you will.
Yes.
Do we have anything else to talk about? This seems
like
the
best
part of it. We're done. See you next week, guys. Because nothing personal, but this might be my favorite part of the interview today.
Oh, yeah, maybe. It's all downhill from here.
Good stuff. Barry Pearl.
Brett Chapin. Dorothy Bloom.
Let's talk about you.
Okay, if you want to. I think you found out a lot about me.
We have, actually, yeah.
I'm a real foodie.
I think so.
I'm stupid, when it comes to, I love my eating.
Food's important.
Really.
It is important.
You need it to live.
Yeah.
And you mentioned you've done many, many shows, and you've done them in several places around the country, and what an opportunity. I think you learn a lot from a community, from a town.
By their cuisine, absolutely.
Yes.
And you know what? Ribs. Hello.
Mm.
This is speaking to my man over here. I'm a Jew who knows his pork. let me tell you.
Yes.
Baby back ribs, forget about it. And I've had them all over the U.S.
Yeah.
And I
you're
could
a barbecue
go on.
Jew.
Oh, I'm a barbecue Jew. Yeah. You got that right.
That is.
Boy, do I love me some ribs.
Going on the Facebook quote, Barry Pearl, I'm a barbecue Jew.
Yeah. That's a awesome. Jew who knows his pork.
A Jew who knows his pork.
There that's, you go. Yeah. Yours is barbecue Jew. I like that a lot. I think I'm both.
Yeah.
But that's another one. And you're right. Wherever I go, I eat my way through. Even in Europe, you know, whenever I've been.
Absolutely. Just, oh, I do that.
My tongue
and also
guide me.
Artisan beers. I also like.
Oh yeah.
Are finding the local artisan beer makers.
Yeah. All good stuff. Mm-hmm. All good. So we're so fortunate. God, we are so fortunate. And that's for serious. We are really fortunate to be able to talk about this stuff when other stuff is going on in this world. We tend to forget about it. So in this moment, and I'm really serious, dead serious, that we are so fortunate to be able to sit behind microphones, do what we love to do, dancing, singing, whatever it is, you engineering, when there's all this crap going on in the world.
Mm-hmm.
And we forget about it. So in this moment, let's take a moment and really, you know, suck that up. You know what I'm saying?
I couldn't agree more.
So, cool. Very cool.
And I think it's productions like 12 Angry Men that I think art has that great opportunity to reflect those crap things going on in the world and do it in a way that makes people sit down and watch the whole damn thing.
That's as long as we can have a conversation after the piece. That's to get the piece up there and expose these particular expressions that Reginald Rose was exposing and continues to through the work.
Right.
And have people go away and have the conversation. Then we've done our job.
We're talking with actor Barry Pearl of Pasadena Playhouse's 12 Angry Men. If you have any questions for him, give us a call at 323-473-3100, 323-473-3100.
It's right.
And is this the original script, or is it the Roundabout Theater's adaptation?
It's really the Roundabouts.
Mm-hmm.
But what director Sheldon Epps, who's also the artistic director of the Pasadena Playhouse and dear, dear friend and colleague of mine, we went to Carnegie Mellon University together, what he's done is he has chosen to cast 6 black men and 6 white men.
Oh.
So race, which is always been a thread through this piece, really is highlighted here, really comes to the forefront. And it makes it so very relevant, as it always has been. It's like nothing has changed.
Mm-hmm.
So at the core of this is this issue, because we're there, just 12 men deciding the fate of a young man of color, possibly. We don't know, though some of the reviews seem to think they know. It is never discussed.
Mm-hmm.
In the film, in the 1997 version with Jack Lemmon and George C. Scott, if I recall, the opening shot is, I believe, of a ceiling fan that then pans down. We realize we're in the courtroom, onto the defendant, who happens to be Hispanic, and then cut to the judge and her opening speech, which we don't have that opening speech. We actually begin the piece about a page in. And the only alterations that he's made is there are scenes in the play that take place in another room, in a bathroom.
Mm-hmm.
Those scenes have been cut, basically. Mm-hmm. So it all takes place in this one room. And
so the thing with the knife is cut?
Yeah, no. That's all in there.
That's all
but
in
there. Okay. There are two scenes that take place in the bathroom between certain jurors.
I thought the knife thing was in the bathroom.
No. The knife thing is as I recall, is in the... it has to be in the room because it's so much is about
Right, right.
And discussed, and there's stuff revealed there, so that all takes place in the jury room. But so it hasn't been altered very much. There's a line of mine that has been altered to enhance an expression of my feeling about the race, and there is another character's who has a similar thing that has happened. But otherwise, the lines, you know, he hasn't touched it any more than that. But I urge people to come out and see this and have the conversations that we want you to have. It's quite controversial. And Sheldon's done a brilliant job in casting. Jason George, who plays the Juror 8 from Grey's Anatomy, plays Miranda Bailey's husband.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
You know what I'm talking about?
Yes, I know exactly who
and,
that is.
And so he plays eight. Gregory North is three. So those are the two central characters.
Yes.
And then Bob Picardo plays juror number four, who Bob, we know from many, many things. He was most recognized as the holographic doctor in Star Trek Voyager.
Oh.
So you'd know him. And just a great cast of players, fabulous cast of players.
And is it set in... is it set in the original time, or is it
the program says then and now?
Okay,
so you don't know when it's set.
So it's got a real contemporary feel about it.
Mm-hmm.
We don't have cell phones in the which we could have iPads and cell phones to refer. Which would definitely place us today. There are references to placing ads in the paper for $3 or getting or being paid $3 a day for our jury service, which is very much then as opposed to now. But excuse me, you get the feeling that it's today. The dress is kind of amorphous.
Mm-hmm.
The costuming could be.
Well, that's helpful when it's all men.
Yes,
I think that's more difficult to do when women's costumes involved.
Yes, correct. This play has been done with women.
Of course,
it's been done with mixed race. It's been done with men and women. So this is the way this one's being done. It was interesting that one of the critics said something about what about a jury of one's peers? It's an 18-year-old kid on trial. Well, the original was 12 white men.
Yeah.
I came to learn, this is so naive of me, but I came to learn, we had a talk back Tuesday?
Mm-hmm.
After the show. Tuesday. And we had Judge Ito there seeing the show.
And, oh, my Lord.
Yeah. And some other lawyers and judges. And this one lady said that a jury of one's peers is just other human beings.
Hmm.
You know, it does. That's the those are our peers.
Mm-hmm.
They don't have to be children or teenagers. They just have to be humans, because you don't know what. Because the court doesn't know what the panel's that day is going to look like, what the pool of potential jurors is going to look like. You know, so now in voir dire, of course, they are able to eliminate certain people, but you get as close as you can.
Mm-hmm. You know. Oh, voir dire. Good Lord.
Yes.
What a process.
I know, indeed. I got real close to being impaneled once. All the times that I'd been asked, you know, being in the entertainment business, our schedules are so nuts, so it's hard to be able to commit. Well, nowadays, that don't matter.
Yeah, it does not matter at all.
No, but I got up to actually, I was an alternate,
mm-hmm.
and I got into the box and was eliminated. You know, so I got that far. I was eliminated by one of the judges, one of the lawyers. You don't know which one, but the judge said, you can go. Wow, okay. You know, and I want to tell you that most of us spend our time when we get notified, how can I get out of this? How can I get out? But, you know, after doing this show, I almost wish that I had that experience.
Mm-hmm.
And certainly now, you know, I would welcome the experience more now.
Well, I was a juror last year in August, and then Theater Palisades did 12 Angry Men almost directly after my service.
Yes.
And so it was fascinating to go and watch it afterwards because, you know, I mean, I didn't get, I was actually removed from myself from the box.
Yes.
But it was fascinating how your day is dependent on the other jurors. And and their ability to comprehend the rules.
Absolutely.
I mean, there was one guy that literally fell asleep during testimony. The testimony. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
And they had to go back, and they had to go with the transcription lady and go through all of this testimony
with
him.
So he had it all. Well, this in the same fashion. This piece centers around one particular juror who is not voting with the other guys. And now what do we do?
Yeah.
Now what do we do? And how all of that unfolds and how minds get changed and changed back. And but you're right, you're at the mercy of, you know, 11 other guys, you know, or guys or gals, depending, like you say.
Yeah.
So you don't know how it's gonna unfold.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
And the great thing about the Pasadena Playhouse is that you guys have shows six nights a week.
Yes,
right?
Tuesday through Sunday. It's Tuesday night, Wednesday night, Thursday night. Friday night, two on Saturday, and two on Sunday. Ooh. A matinee and an evening.
That's great.
And I tell you, it's this show, there's not a lot of bipping and bopping, singing and dances, dancing, but it is exhausting because we are so focused.
Yes.
When we're not speaking, we are intent on whoever is or whomever we're supposed to be, another character we're supposed to be dealing with while something else is going on. So it is mentally exhausting.
I have tickets for Tuesday.
Oh, good.
I cannot wait.
Oh, good. Because you had mentioned you were going to see something at the Geffen. I said, oh, gosh, I hope they're going to see
this. Oh, that's today.
That's today.
Right. Yeah. Right. But that's great. I can't wait for you. People are on their feet at the end of each performance. You know, it's interesting as well. I'm certain that you know. When you do a comedy or doing a musical, there are laughs, and of course there's applause after numbers, one hopes. But here, there are some laughs that really feel like valves are being opened so the steam can escape for a while because the pressure has gotten so high. We don't know until certainly the end of the first act even. They're hooping and hollering. And of course at the end of the second act, they're up on their feet, and then we realize they've taken the ride.
And you so know? This is presented with an intermission.
Yes,
it
is.
Because sometimes it's presented
they've done it all the way through. Yes, they have done that. This one does have a really nice intermission. It has been a blessed experience. And we've talked about this. We don't want to leave the theater at night. We want to go and hang. Sure. We want to talk. We want to be in each other's company, these guys. And it's funny because it's antithetical to how we behave with how the characters
of course
behave with each other in the piece. Mm-hmm. We're at each other's throats. And to be able to do that well, it's like ordered chaos. Mm-hmm. You know, you have to have a connection. You have to have the affinity, the respect and the understanding to then be able to have no respect and no understanding, if you will.
Right.
So it's choreographed in that way.
Mm-hmm.
And it has just been such a delicious process. I kind of like to get the rehearsal process over with so I can get on with the art at hand. I just have always been that way. And I tell you, I've been savoring each and every millimoment, had been, I should say, of the rehearsal process, and now, of course, of the performance. And we're always discovering things, too. Mm-hmm. Every single performance, there's a little tweak, a little zhuzh, a little something, wow, that we realize. And it just allows for that. And Sheldon is a deliciously gentle director. He doesn't direct traffic. He lets you do your thing.
Mm-hmm.
You move where you feel you need to go, and then he'll tweak. And it was just a wonderfully gentle and productive process. So, and we just all of us are of the same mind. We don't want to leave the theater. We hang and we hang and we talk. We have friends that come to see the show and ask questions, and we're so willing to engage in all the conversations. You know, so you'll come and you'll have that experience.
Yes, I look forward to seeing it.
Yeah. I mean, I have like a list of questions, but you've pretty much covered most of them.
Okay. Well,
how does this relate to the court system today, do you think?
Well, to the court system, did you say?
Our justice system.
Oh,
yeah.
I think that it's always as it has been. The justice, of course, tries to be blind and go with the facts as stated, and you have people that have different perceptions. It's truly like Rashomon. You're seeing the same thing, but from different angles. And I think that is, it was ever thus. So that hasn't changed at all. I assume, again, I've never been part of this process in real life, but I imagine it's not much different. You have people in there arguing the way they have seen it, either having other arguments sway them, or their arguments sway others. So, you know, as far as race issues go, as
it's all still relevant.
As forwarder as we've gone, that's as behinder as we've got.
Yeah.
You know, I was just, one of my castmates had sent a link to an op-ed piece in the Los Angeles Times that disrespect race and Obama. And, it's an interview. There was an interview on the BBC with Oprah Winfrey, where she said of Obama, "There's a level of disrespect for the office that occurs, and that occurs in some cases, and maybe even many cases, because he's African American." And it says, with that remark, Winfrey touched on an issue that many Americans have wrestled with, and it is, to what extent does this president's race animate those loyal to him and those opposed? Is race a primary motivator or a subordinate, more elusive one, tainting motivations but not driving them? And then Limbaugh, in his inimitable, stupid way, says, if black people in this country are so mistreated and so disrespected, how in the name of Sam Hill did you happen, referring to Oprah Winfrey? Would somebody explain that to me? If there's a level of disrespect simply because he's black, then how, Oprah, have you managed to become the, at one time, most popular and certainly wealthiest television personality? How does that happen? Is this man not an idiot? I mean, this is the first time I've saying this on maybe national radio, but I think this man is an idiot, and he deserves not to be on the air. He says, no one has ever accused of Limbaugh of being a complex thinker, but the intellectual deficiency required to achieve that level of arrogance and ignorance is staggering. I couldn't have said it better. So there are some people that are opposed, blatantly opposed, to him because of his race. And there are degrees of that opposition. Others may think that they're not, and yet they truly are. How do you discern it? So this play that we're doing, 12 Angry Men at the Pasadena Playhouse, what it deals with is so pertinent and relevant, for no other reason than this article, this op-ed in the LA Times today, for no other reason than this appearing. Mm-hmm. So we're continuing to have this conversation, yet nobody's satisfied with the answers. How do we answer the questions? Can't we all just get along?
I don't know if that question's even possible to answer. I mean, it's one of those things where
you're just going to have to do your best
for people.
Yeah, you do your best. What were you talking about? The little things in Mary Poppins about degrees of doing the small things, taking small doses. But there are some that won't even take those.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's unfortunate. And again, 'twas ever thus. It's man's basic inhumanity to man. It's the tragic flaw in us. And ain't that just terrible? Because it seems for those liberals of us that it's a no-brainer. Just stop it.
Mm-hmm.
Just take a different look at it from another angle, you know, like in this piece, this 12 Angry Men. If you look at it from this angle, you'll see it's not as it appears. And, you know, maybe that's just what's in our DNA, and we have to live with that. Who knows?
Hopefully it's improving. You know, hopefully it's getting better.
You know, there are glimpses of it.
Changes.
We're having these conversations. It's just like watching the hands of a clock.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So slow.
Yeah.
So slow.
But, you know, I mean, 30, 40 years ago, we couldn't even use the same water fountains.
That's true. That is true.
Mm-hmm.
That's absolutely true. I heard something recently, an idea recently, that Lincoln freeing the slaves may not have been such a great idea because you're now left with a race of people who now, what do we do now? You know, what do those folks do now? Some are still considered slaves by white people that live in other parts of this country. They still feel that way. And then you have these displaced folks who have always been treated like slaves but have had roofs over their head and have been fed. But now what do they do? And the resentment that is part of that fabric from that point on. So where we think great people are free, well, what does that freedom comes with a cost? What does that freedom mean now to these folks? Certainly not the freedom of the people that still own the plantations. So, you know, what did we do by stealing these folks from their natural lands to serve us? And that goes for any race of people.
Mm-hmm.
What a terrible, terrible thing to do to each other.
Yeah.
Awful terrible. And maybe this conversation, you're right, we could not have had years ago.
I think we would have, you know, had some trouble, you and I, if we had been having this conversation years ago.
Yes, exactly.
You know, the three of us.
Exactly, but, exactly. So let's talk about other things.
Yeah,
on
let's
my
talk
resume.
About. Honestly, it's like some guests, you know, you got to really drag stuff out of them. Barry, I can sit here and the interview does itself.
Yes, exactly.
It's beautiful.
I told you.
Let's talk about Greece,
sure,
real quick, because that's what everybody everyone's so familiar with that movie.
Sure.
Can you tell us a little bit about the experience of being cast and what the process of the filming was like?
You know,
You were duty in Greece.
I played duty in Greece. The story goes, in the summer of 1972, when Greece had already opened on Broadway, I was a member of the Chicago Free Street Theater. And we had gone to my, it was actually the summer before my senior year, and then the first half of my senior year at Carnegie Mellon. They allowed me to travel with the street theater to Europe, presenting these original shows to, gosh, to people that never even seen theater before. We would, in Illinois, all over Illinois, we'd travel in a showmobile, a trailer. And then when we went to Europe, we were sponsored by Pierre Cardin at the Espace Cardin in Paris, and the Belgrade International Theater Festival, traveled all over Yugoslavia, and then to Brussels for about a week or two to perform there. And so the school gave me credit to do that. Well, one of my castmates, John Lansing, who went on to become a writer and producer for Walker, Texas Ranger, and all kinds of things, has a book out now. Gosh, I forget the name of the book. It's a work of fiction, a crime drama of some sort. In any event,
I like that show.
Walker? Yeah. And John, after we were through with the street theater in January of 73, he had gone on to become the understudy for Danny Zuko, Johnny Cassino, and some of the other roles in the first national tour of Greece.
Nice.
It was traveling around the city. Now, I had gone back to Pittsburgh to go to school. So, to finish up my senior year. And friends of mine that I'd gone to school with who were transfer students from out here in California kept telling me how much I reminded them of their friend Michael Lembeck. I looked like him. I did the same roles in the same plays, yada-da-yada-da-yada-da-yada. Well, Greece comes through Pittsburgh. John gives me a call and says, why don't you come down and see this show? You'd really like it. I go down to see the show, and Michael Lembeck is in the show. He's playing Sonny. Michael comes walking out on stage, and his character actually was directed to walk out backwards. So picture that. He's pissed off that he just got old lady Lynch for English, right? And he turns around, and it was like watching myself.
That's creepy.
Creepy. And I got on the phone the next day with my agent in New York and said, you got to get me a general audition for this. I can do that role somewhere down the line. Agent calls, gets me an audition. So I fly into New York like that weekend or the next week or whatever, and I audition a general audition. I come back to school. A week later, I get a telephone call saying Michael Lembeck has broken his ankle in the We Go Together number at the end of the first act. They want you to come in to New York to audition for a callback. I couldn't believe it. So I did. Turns out Pat Birch, who had done You're a Good Man, Charlie Brown with in 1967 and 68, the Boston company of the show, was choreographing. And I got the gig. And they said, we want you to come up and replace Michael while he's on the mend up to Toronto. Well, I still had 2 weeks of school to finish. So they let me finish school, then flew me to Detroit, where they were going to be. And I understudied the understudy, but only concentrating on the role of Sonny. If any of the other guys went down that understudy person covered, they'd plug in, and then I'd go into the role of Sonny. The role of Sonny. So I was there for about 3 weeks rehearsing my tush off and really wanting to do the role. Jerry Zaks was playing Kinnicky. Now, Jerry Zaks is a big Broadway director. Guys and Dolls, Civil War. He's done a lot of stuff. Forum, I think he had done as well. The revival with Nathan Lane. I said to Jerry, hey, look, could you play sick on Saturday so I could go on? He said, well, only if company management says it's okay. Well, they weren't going to do that, but all right, fine, if that's what you got to do. Came back to me and said, no. They said, no, fine. Saturday morning, May 19th. Of 1973, I'm in my hotel room, and I get the call from the stage manager, you're going on, Jerry Zaks is sick. Now, whether they had planned it and they just didn't want me to be part of the ruse, I'll never know, but I went on. That was the first. So I stepped on stage playing Sonny, May 19th, 1973, at the Fisher Theater in Detroit.
Yeah.
May 19th of 1977, out here in California, I'd auditioned for the movie and had my call back on the 19th of May, and got the gig. So 4 years to the day later, I got the role of Sonny. Now, just backing, that's the punch to the story, backing up a little bit. None of us thought we'd have a shot at it, having been in the play. They didn't want people encumbered with all of that stuff. They wanted Tabula Rosas, basically. But that didn't prove to be the case. Michael Tucci, who plays Sonny in the movie, was an understudy in the first national tour. Jamie Donnelly had played the role of Jan or had understudied Jan. I can never get that straight. So she knew. And, of course, Travolta played Duty in the production in the First National Company. Jeff Conaway, may he rest in peace, was playing Zuko in the First National Company. And he, to me, was the definitive Zuko. In fact, in my life, we were kids together, he was a Zuko character. So getting this role, and then the 15 weeks that we shot was a labor of love. It was just a spectacular experience for all of us. And we never know. I know the question is, did you know at the time? You have to have a crystal ball. Nobody ever knows that their project will be a hit. And we certainly, if we'd had any inkling, we wouldn't have believed that it would have become what it is today.
I mean, it wasn't just a hit. It's spawned like it. so much
yeah,
from it.
There's never been anything like it, and to be part of that phenomenon in my life is just such a
blessing. I see
a reference
to it or a comment about it every single week.
Yeah.
Every single week. I was watching The Neighbors on ABC. It's a great show on Friday nights. Uh-huh. And, you know, it's about alien families that come and live in a suburb of New Jersey.
Yes.
And hilarious, by the way. Absolutely yeah. hilarious. And at one point, the main alien and his wife, they have become obsessed with Grease. Oh. And so they've watched all the movies in preparation to go see the musical at the local community theater where Zuko's being played by the librarian. And
yes.
They're so excited, and they dress up as the characters, and
yes.
they're so excited. And that's, it's very telling because it is the introduction to an era,
that's
a particular
right.
era that a lot of people have.
Well, the coming of age.
Yes.
You know, that we all go through. And to be able to tell that story in song and dance, like that kind of song and
mm-hmm.
that kind of dance that so tickles the ears
yeah.
and the eyes. So that's what keeps it appealing through the ages.
Right.
You know, I was playing, how are we?
We don't have time.
We don't, okay, come on.
But I gotta ask you one question, but
sure.
I have to put you on a clock for it if you don't mind.
No, it's fine.
Baby, It's You. Talk about
yes,
Baby, It's You.
Yes, Baby, It's You. Again, at the Pasadena Playhouse, mm-hmm. Where I'm doing a 12 Angry Men right now. That was my first show there a couple of years ago, which went to Broadway. It, too, was a race issue at the core. Florence Greenberg was the woman who discovered the Shirelles, the black girl group back in the day. And she left her Jewish husband. I played Bernie Greenberg, and fell in love with Luther. Gosh, what's Luther's last name? The character Luther. I want to say Henderson, but it's not Henderson. Alan Lewis played the character here and in New York, black record producer. Mm-hmm. And so race was part of that piece too. We went to Broadway with it and played in New York for 5 months.
Fantastic.
And I celebrated my 50th anniversary in show business at the Broadhurst Theater, right next to the Schubert, where I began in 1961 doing Bye Bye Birdie. So there are a lot of these woo-woo things that have happened
what?
In my
love
life.
It. Love
there,
it.
There's a. We'll do a sequel to this. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you. It's been a pleasure.
Barry Pearl, actor, vocalist, dancer. He does it all. He's doing 12 Angry Men right now at the Pasadena Playhouse, PasadenaPlayhouse.com for information on that. And you can find more information about Barry at BarryPearl.com. Next week on La La Land. Thanks for joining us, Barry.
It's a pleasure.
Next week, we have the amazing Lena Hill, Lena Gwendolyn, I should
mm-hmm.
say. She has a show on Tuesday at the Lemon Room, Lemon Room LA. She's going to come in and give us all the information about that. We also have the Kentwood Kids coming in.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. Drew Fitzsimmons is coming in with the Kentwood Kids. It's Kentwood Playhouse. This is youth theater. They're going to tell us all about what they're doing over there.
Good times.
And we also have the cast and director and producer of The Bel Air, which I know a little something about, playing at the El Portal Theater. What is this?
A little bit.
Oh, yeah,
bit.
Yeah. Just a little bit.
I squishy your head. That's the other thing I do. I squish your head.
I thought it was the world's smallest violin playing My Heart Bleeds for You.
That's not this.
Oh, okay. I get my finger signs confused. Go to our Facebook at facebook.com/lalalandtalk, twitter.com/lalalandtalk. Send us an email at lalalandtalk@gmail.com. And we'll see you on episode 137 next week. La La Land, Brett and Dorothy on LA Talk Live.
Have a great one.